Timișoara este un reper al democrației și un model pentru conceptul de multiculturalism, concept care este promovat la nivelul cel mai înalt în cadrul construcției comunitare. Timișoara este orașul în care, în 1989, tineri și oameni maturi s-au sacrificat pentru ca noi să ne bucurăm astăzi de privilegiul de a trăi liber, de a putea redeveni un stat democratic. Universitatea de Vest din Timișoara este un pilon important al zonei din vestul țării, fiind cea mai importantă structură academică care de curând și-a aniversat 70 de ani de existență. În prezent, universitatea noastră este recunoscută la nivel național, european și internațional pentru calitatea actului educațional, dar și pentru rezultatele cercetării științifice și pentru parteneriatele pe care le are. Comunitatea academică a Universității de Vest din Timișoara încearcă constant să ofere bine meritată recunoaștere unor nume importante din lumea științifică, culturală, socială, politică, iar personalitatea domnului Durao Barroso este una complexă. Fațetele acesteia, îndreptățindu-ne, să-i oferim astăzi cea mai înaltă distincție onorifică a universității noastre, titlul de doctor honoris causa beneficiorum publicorum. Excelența sa, domnul José Manuel Durao Barroso, este licențiat în drept la Universitatea din Lisabona, studiile de master fiind urmate la Institutul European al Universității din Geneva, cu accent pus pe științe economice și pe cele sociale. Profesorul José Manuel Durao Barroso are o intensă activitate academică, fiind printre altele visiting professor la Graduate Institute of International Studies din cadrul Universității din Geneva și la Princeton University din Statele Unite ale Americii. Omul politic, José Manuel Durao Barroso, a cunoscut o carieră fulminantă. Astfel, începând cu 1987, este secretar de stat pentru afaceri externe și cooperare, din 1992 până în 1995, ministrul afacerilor externe al Republicii Portugheze, iar din 2002 conduce guvernul de la Lisabona, pentru ca din 2004, pentru o perioadă de 10 ani, să fie ales în demnitatea de președinte al Comisiei Europene.
Bona ad genus humanum altandum, et ad infirmitatem hominis adiutandum, bono societatis, et videntes nos beneficia alata alme nostre matri, cum consensione et caritatea sua diligentia, in nomine omnium collegarum, Dominus José Manuel Durao Barroso, declaratur doctor honoris causa beneficiorum publicorum, ad maiorem suam gloriam et in signo considerationis nostre. Omnia hec firmamus sigillo rectorali et signationibus sequentibus, rector professor universitarius doctor Marilen Gabriele Pirtea, presse senatus universitatis professor universitarius doctor Alexander Bublea. Civitate Timisiensi, die vicesima nova, mense primo, anno domine millesimo duo sexagesimo. Să-l aplaudăm!
Mr. Hector, Professor Pitea, Prime Minister, the Chancellors, Vice Prime Minister, distinguished ministers, representatives of the Orthodox Church, members of the Parliament, ambassadors, the prefect of the Timiş County, the mayor of Timișoara, rectors of different universities here present, professors, honorable members of the Senate, representatives of different institutions of the civil society and the economy of this region, distinguished guests, dear students, dear friends. First of all, let me tell that it is indeed with great honor and great satisfaction that I received this distinction that makes me now a member of the academic community of the West University in Timișoara. I thank you. I thank the rector. I thank the Senate. I thank the Laudatio Committee of West University Timișoara. And I thank you because it means to me a lot, this distinction, not only because it comes from a very important institution of teaching and researching here in a country that I admire and that I love, in Romania. Allow me also to have a special word of thanks to a friend of mine who came today to Timișoara to be present in this moment, current Prime Minister Dacian Ciolos. We have worked in the European Commission from 2009 to 2014, and knowing his competence, his integrity, and his enthusiasm, I'm sure that Romania, the Romanian government, is in good hands, and I wish you, Dacian, all the best in your very important functions today. I know that this university is indeed a competent, very serious, and dynamic one. And I'm also very pleased to be here in Timișoara, one of the most important Romanian cities, a city with a great history, a very old city indeed, also with a tradition of multiculturalism, at the same time proud to be Romanian, and one city that has its name associated with the Romanian Revolution and with democracy. Being myself Portuguese, knowing what it is to watch the fall of an authoritarian regime, as it happened in my country in 74, I feel close to you here in Timișoara and in Romania. I feel close to those that when they were young, like myself, I was 18 years of age, we could see the fall of an authoritarian regime and the birth of a democracy. I still remember that experience in my country, and I know by my own experience how important it is to create a new democratic regime, to put an end to an authoritarianism that not only was denying our peoples the basic freedoms, but was also making it difficult for our countries, Romania and Portugal, to join the democratic families of nations that were united in the European Community and are today united in the European Union. And I also know that the European Union, it's not only about the consolidation of democracies, it's also about creation of prosperity, about economic, social, and cultural development. Thanks to the solidarity offered by the European Union and the cohesion policy, Portugal made remarkable progress since it joined the European Union in 1986. And now I see Romania, that joined the European Union in 2007, having the same prospects and indeed making very important steps. I see already the results of structural funds that have been invested in this city, Timișoara, that is going through a very important process of renewal. I see also the funds of the European programs that are being invested through Horizon 2020 and before to the, through the seven framework program in universities, like here in the University of Timișoara, in other universities of this region, and indeed in the universities of Romania. And I know also the contribution that the structural funds that the Common Agricultural Policy is giving to the progress, social, economic, and cultural progress of your country. So please consider me a friend of Romania, because I really believe that the transformations that your country has gone and is going through are extremely important for the future of this country, and I feel a lot of sympathy because in my country we have been going through similar challenges. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I just mentioned Horizon 2020, and indeed this is one of the things I am proud, because when I was leading the Commission we were able, even if we were living very difficult moments from a financial point of view, we have been able to increase by more than 40% the budget for research in Europe. We have indeed committed 80 billion euros for research through that program, Horizon 2020, that, as I've said, the University of Timișoara is already benefiting. I really mean it when I speak about research, education, culture, and universities. All politicians like to say that they like education. With me, I really mean it, and it's true. And in fact, since I left office, I came back to academia. I am now have the pleasure of teaching in the United States at Princeton University, but also in my country at Catholic University in Lisbon and also in Geneva. I believe that our universities have a great role to play, developing research, science, but also being linked to the development of our communities. And I'm sure that this University of West Timișoara is precisely doing that. I believe that the role of education is extremely important, not only for economic development as an instrument for development, but because education is an end in itself. It's about the fulfillment of a human being. What is more important for a human being than to have the possibility to learn, to enlarge its horizons in culture or in science? So that's why I really believe it's very important, all the efforts that the governments can do to support universities, to support science, to support research, and indeed, I think that the future of Europe is to a large extent depending on the capacity of Europe to innovate, to create more science, and of the role of its universities. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, when I was invited to accept this honoris causa degree, I was told that I should make a speech and that the speech should be about Europe. So, with your permission, I'm now going to ask you to listen to me some minutes about Europe and about the European Union. I know well what it is, the conventional wisdom, all the clichés that exist about Europe today. Europe, crisis. Crisis, Europe. One of my students in Princeton, she said that she Googled the words European Union and Google and the crisis, and she discovered more than 1 million references to crisis and to Europe. So everywhere crisis. Financial crisis, economic crisis, social crisis, political crisis. I mean, Europe is, some people say, in a desperate crisis. Indeed, during my two mandates leading the European Commission, I think I became expert in crisis. Not only the financial and sovereign debt crisis, some people call the euro crisis, but let's not forget the constitutional crisis when there was the rejection by two founding members of the European Union of the constitutional treaty, something that we had to solve afterwards through the Lisbon Treaty. But we solved it. Many people were predicting that the European Union would not be able to solve that imbroglio, institutional imbroglio, and we solved it through the Lisbon Treaty. We had also a crisis like the geopolitical crisis, when Russia made the annexation of Crimea, and that conflict that unfortunately is not yet solved. So a geopolitical crisis. And of course we had during these years the very substantial, unprecedented financial crisis. But let's look now at the facts. Let's make an effort of memory. Do you remember what was said some years ago, for instance in 2009, 2010, 2011, when everybody, the financial analysts from New York to London and all over the world, they were predicting Greece leaving the euro, the famous Grexit. We are in 2016 and Greece is still in the euro. So they were wrong. All those that were predicting this were wrong. Do you remember 2010, 11, 12? Most analysts, commentators, historians, experts, professors predicting the implosion of the euro, the end of the euro, the crumbling of the economic and monetary union. But they were wrong. The euro is and remains one of the two most important currencies in the world, a stable, credible, and strong currency. So indeed, and this is my point, we should, when we make analysis of Europe, as when we make the analysis of whatever phenomenon, not just look at today or the emergency situation. We should try to put things in perspective, in time perspective, and also in geographical perspective. We should compare. It's not because I have this passion for optimism. It is because I reject the intellectual glamour of pessimism. It is because I believe we should be rigorous in an analysis of a situation. What happened with Europe? What happened with the euro? First of all, the crisis was not the crisis of the euro. It put some challenges in the euro, but it was a crisis that was originated out of Europe. The country that was most affected by it, in fact, it was not even member of the European Union, it was Iceland. And that crisis, financial crisis, as you know, has touched countries inside the euro and outside the euro. Indeed, Romania was going through extremely difficult moments. But what happened was that we were able to create programs for the countries most affected in the euro area, from Ireland to Greece to Portugal to Spain, that received also a program for the banks, and those countries, with the exception of Greece that is still struggling, those countries were able to exit successfully their adjustment programs. And now some of them are among the fastest growing countries in Europe, like Ireland. Today, all countries in the European Union are no longer in recession. Certainly, it is not a very spectacular growth, but it is growth. And our countries are doing better now than some of the emerging market economies that some time ago were telling how to deal with debt crisis. So I really believe, based on the experience I have not only on 10 years leading the European Commission, but also in different capacities in my national government of dealing with the European Union, that the European Union has shown its resilience, that the forces of integration are stronger than the forces of disintegration or fragmentation. I do not ignore the difficulties and the challenges, I can tell you. I was living through extremely demanding times and very serious problems, and I come back to that in a moment. But I ask you to think dynamically, not just at the moment, not just look at the photo, but try to see the movie, and try to see where we were and where we are. In fact, as a response to the financial crisis, we were able to build new institutions, new mechanisms in Europe. We have now a European Stability Mechanism that is a kind of a IMF for Europe. We have now a banking union, not yet complete, but a banking union that will be unthinkable some years before, with direct powers of the European Central Bank on supervision of the banks. In some matters, the European Central Bank has more powers than the Federal Reserve of the United States of America. So indeed, we have used the crisis as a spillover effect to create more integration at European Union level. Yes, Europe is possible in Europe. If there is sufficient political will of our governments, it is possible to go further in terms of integration. Yes, it is true. Sometimes it is very frustrating. It is time consuming. It is slow. Sometimes it is polarizing, the way we take decisions in Europe. Because we are a union of democracies, we cannot take a decision by diktat. We have to make the consensus. Europe is about a culture of compromise. There is not one country that can impose, and that's the way we want it, like impose its will on the others. So we need a lot of accommodation, compromise, successive approximation. So our decision making in Europe is incremental by nature. During the most difficult moments of the crisis, I remember speaking with the President of the United States and others were asking, why don't you do this quicker? And I was explaining to them that we are not the United States of Europe. We are the European Union, where we need, of course, to take in consideration different perspectives. So yes, it's slow. Yes, it's frustrating, but at the end, I believe it works. Of course, I would like to see things quicker. That's why we are advocating, and the Commission, under my leadership and today's Commission, is defending some steps further, not only in economic union, but for a political union. But for those who are completely negative about Europe, I ask them to think in terms of the time evolution. And then look at my own experience, 2004, 2014. In 2004, how many members we had in the European Union? 15. In 2014, and today we have 28. So it means that during all these crises, it was possible for the European Union almost to double its membership. This is not typical of organizations in crisis. Organizations in crisis, they disappear. They do not double its membership. And for those who are predicting the end of the euro, now we have 19 countries in the euro area, in the Economic and Monetary Union. It means that we have today more countries in the euro area than we had before in 2004 in all the European Union. This shows that, in fact, there are reasons to be confident. Of course, and now I'm going to be completely honest with you, we have very serious challenge today. I'm still concerned about the current moment of Europe, namely because of this populism, this nationalism that we see in many quarters of Europe. There is a difference between patriotism and nationalism. As a great French author said, Romain Gary, he said, le patriotisme c'est l'amour des siens, le nationalisme c'est la haine des autres. Patriotism is to love what belongs to us, and that's good. Nationalism is to hate others, and this is bad. And today, in some parts of Europe, and not only in Europe, we see this nationalism and this populism. Look also what happens in the United States of America, where one of the leading candidates is making xenophobic remarks. Xenophobic remarks. And this makes us think, are we able? Are we, all those who share the ideas of democracy and freedom, but we are moderate people, are we able to win that battle against those extremisms? It's very important. It's not only in Europe, it's all over the world. Because of globalization, because people are afraid of what's happening. And we know that when there is fear, there is a temptation to more radical movements from the extreme right to the extreme left. I believe we have to fight that with courage. But of course, nothing is taken for granted. So when people ask me, and they ask me very often, what do you think it's going to happen in Europe I say it depends. It depends on you. It depends on what you do. Because if we Europeans put ourselves just as spectators, then the future is not going to be bright. But if you think that what we have built over these decades is something that we should join and defend, then we have all reasons to be confident. I really believe that we are living a moment of anxiety. I'm completely aware of that. But once again, I think, like one of the founding fathers of the European community, Jean Monnet, that, and I'm quoting again in French, l'Europe se fera dans les crises et ce sera la réponse à des crises successives. Europe is going to be made in crisis. And it is precisely those successive responses to the crisis that will make Europe stronger. So yes, I think we should not give up to pessimism. I think we should have the capacity to resist. But let me tell you very frankly that sometimes I get angry. I get angry when I see some analysts, including professors, saying things about Europe that show only their ignorance. Just recently, I read an article of a great, or considered to be a great historian, and he said, Europe now it's in decline. Europe, European Union, the European community was great in the 70s. In the 70s? Does he know what he's saying? When Romania and all Central Eastern European countries were under totalitarianism and to a large extent dependent on the Soviet power, was this the great moment of Europe in the 70s? When my country, Portugal, or Spain, or Greece were under authoritarian regimes, was this the great moment of Europe? How can anyone say that the 70s were the great moment of Europe? Because they are thinking about a small Europe. They are speaking about the Europe of 9 members. But that was not Europe, it was a part of Europe. Very cozy, but not the real Europe. Now, thanks to the enlargement, we have the real continental Europe. As Pope John Paul II said, now Europe can breast with both lungs. That's why the enlargement was one of the greatest achievements in European history. And we have to defend it. That's why I'm so proud that Romania is now a member of the European Union. It makes life less comfortable for some, but now Europe is stronger with this continental dimension. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes we have a tendency to idealize the past. We say today it's everything is bad. Before it was great moments. The problem is that when people start idealizing the past, I think those people are getting old. In fact, they have lost perspective. I was very young as foreign minister. I was in the European Council at the time of Helmut Kohl, because at that time the foreign ministers were members of the European Council, the summit. I was there with Helmut Kohl, with François Mitterrand, with Jacques Delors, with Felipe González, but we were only 12. It was just a part of Europe. So how can people say that Europe was the greatest moment, the finest tower? It was not. Half of Europe was cut of our family, not living in freedom. So to those who say that Europe now is in decadence, is in decline, I ask them, what was the great moment of Europe? Was in the 80s? Was in the 70s? Or was it the 20th century when Europe, we had 2 world wars here? The worst wars in mankind history were here. Only in the First World War, more people died than in all the wars in the history of mankind. Only the First World War, and it was a European war. And the Second War, we had the Holocaust, we had the Shoah, here. In the center of Europe. How can someone say that Europe was better before? Europe today has many difficulties and challenges and difficulties. Among them, for instance, the very high level of unemployment in young people. I'm not underestimating them. But frankly, let's put things in perspective. And let's also compare with other parts of the world. It's true that now we have this refugee problem. Some days ago I was in the United States and people were saying, what have you to say about the crisis of refugees in Europe? And I said, let's think a bit. Yes, we have a difficulty to deal with this matter in Europe. But the real crisis is not in Europe. The crisis is in Syria, is in Iraq, it's in Libya. And people come to Europe because Europe is stable in prosperity and in freedom. By the way, they don't go to Russia, the refugees. They come here to Europe, European Union. So this shows that we have a problem, but compared to our problems of others, frankly, I will not exchange my problems for their problems. Now, regarding the refugee issue, it's a very serious matter. I think more difficult than any other we have been facing recently, because it is testing to the limits the political capacity of Europe to receive those refugees. I believe we have a humanitarian duty to receive the refugees. At the same time, I think we have to be realistic, and Europe cannot receive all illegal migrants. We have to combine solidarity, receiving for humanitarian reasons refugees, with responsibility, fighting against those networks, criminal networks, that explore traffic of human beings. We have to build our external borders strongly. We have to create more Europe also in that field, something that the European Commission has been asking for a long time. But I hope we are going to solve these refugee challenges we have today and this illegal migration, not only for humanitarian reasons, but also for Europe to remain loyal to its values. And I'm using, and I'm now concluding, the word values. Because Europe is not just a market. Of course we have a common market, because we need this as the basis for our exchanges to come, not only the freedom of movement of goods, but also the freedom of movement of capital, of services, and of people. We need to keep completely respected the principle of freedom of movement of people. That's one of the greatest achievements of the European construction. But Europe is about values. And when I had the honor, on behalf of the European Union, to receive the Nobel Peace Prize in 2012 in Norway, I had that occasion of saying how important it is, the construction of values for Europe. That European integration is an integration by the economic means, but the goal is a political one, is peace. Peace. And we never had in the history of Europe until now 60 years of peace as we had in the last decade in this part of Europe. Unfortunately, not all Europe, because we had recently a war in the Balkans, because there is still an undeclared war in Ukraine. So we are not completely in peace, but at least the countries of the European Union, they have been enjoying peace since the foundation of the European Economic Community in the 50s of last century. This is the longest time of peace in our continent. That is why we should reaffirm the European project as a project of peace and a project of values. And I believe a country like Romania has here a special duty, because, as I said, some of the commentators do not feel comfortable with this enlarged Europe. I think it is very important that the new members of the European Union show a complete commitment to democracy and show that it's okay, good to be in Europe to receive, but also to give. Solidarity is indivisible. We cannot be in the European Union just to receive. We also have to give to others, to give our contribution. And I think it's critically important at this very moment of European history that the new member states keep their commitment to the European project. If not, they will reinforce the prejudices that still exist against this enlarged Europe. I'm not on their side. I'm one of those that believe that this enlarged Europe, in spite of all its difficulties, is better than the mini Europe of before. That today, with this continental dimension, we can better defend our values and protect our interests in the wider world. In the 21st century, in the century of globalization, even the biggest countries of Europe alone, they will not have the capacity to discuss in equal terms with our American allies or with China. What can a country of 60 or 80 million people do in front of a country of 1.3 or 1.5 billion people? We need this scale that Europe gives us. And we have now the European Union with more than 500 million people. We are still the number one economy in the world. We are the biggest trade bloc in the world. We are the first giver of foreign assistance. So we have many things to be proud, like the social market economy. We are not perfect. We have our difficulties. But frankly, I believe that we as Europeans have some reasons to be proud, without arrogance, because arrogance is the worst form of stupidity, but to be proud of what we have achieved with the European Union in terms of our values of peace, freedom, and above all, the respect for human dignity. I thank you for your attention.
Că în continuare, zic unui fostul, eu zic reinventatul Imperiul Roman generează gânduri frumoase și generoase. Îi mulțumim domnului doctor honoris causa pentru alocuțiune și aș vrea doar să reamintesc aici ceea ce spuneam nu de mult, tot în această aula magna, și anume că acum se va spune că ar vorbesc pro domo. Dacă am început așa, continui pe aceeași linie, ca să fiu consecvent. Această aula magna noastră primește tot mai mult un fel de genius loci, de spirit al locului și cred că ar trebui să augmentăm denumirea, eventual, mă gândesc, aula destinată egregiarul personal, adică să aduce prin aula logodnică a personalităților distinse, pentru că Uniunea Europeană, în forma actuală, a avut până acum doi președinți și amândoi au primit aici titlul de doctor honoris causa. Deci ceva se întâmplă sau cu locul, sau cu ei, sau cu noi. Există ceva care merită ținut minte și revizuit. Pentru că am amintit la un moment dat de puntea dintre Dacia și Lusitania,